On behalf of the Department of Computer Science and Automation at IISc, I would like to wish you all a very warm welcome to this first public lecture on Foundations of Data Science by Professor Ravi Kannan. As all of you know, big data or data science represent the latest wave in the computing revolution. Now, the volume, the complexity, and the variety of the data that is now becoming available day after day is now at an unprecedented scale. So if you are able to extract useful and actionable knowledge out of this data, that's going to be of a huge benefit. So this initiative, which is called the Big Data Initiative, has just been launched in order to realize the potential of this very exciting and very fascinating and very challenging area. Now, the primary objective of the Big Data Initiative is to build a very strong academic and research ecosystem that would enable India's excellence in this fast emerging area and take India to a leadership position in this area. Now, the faculty at the Department of Computer Science and Automation and also at the Indian Institute of Science have come together to launch this initiative, and they have lined up a series of ambitious programs as a part of this initiative. So the first of these initiatives is going to be the public lectures program, and the primary objective of the public lectures program is to give an introduction, an exposure to all the fascinating research works that are going on in this emerging area, and also to tell you more about the current state of the art in this area. Now, to give you the first public lecture, we have today with us Professor Ravi Kannan, who is a legendary researcher in the area of algorithms and theoretical computer science for a long time. Professor Ravi Kannan is currently an adjunct faculty member at the Department of Computer Science and Automation. And as a principal researcher at the Microsoft Research India, he is leading a very successful group on algorithms at MSR India. And as all of you might know, he delivered the 2012 Professor I.G. Sharma Memorial Lecture in the same faculty hall. And then in 2011, he was the recipient of the very prestigious Donald Knuth Prize for his outstanding contributions in designing creative algorithms for many computationally challenging problems. And let's give Professor Ravi Kannan a wide applause for the Donald Knuth Prize. And 20 years before that, way back in 1991, he was the recipient of the prestigious Fulkerson Prize for his seminal work on estimating the volume of convex sets. So here is a researcher who has made path-breaking contributions on a variety of topics in algorithms. Now, he has designed approximation algorithms for integer programming, and he has designed randomized algorithms for linear algebra, and more recently, learning algorithms for convex sets. So he's truly, in my view, he is the Sunil Manohar Gavaskar of the big data team. And with a wide applause, let's welcome Professor Ravi Kannan and invite him to deliver this first public lecture. Professor Ravi Kannan.
Professor Narahari, for that gracious introduction. We await Sula Tendulkar coming later. But I'll start this lecture. Also, I want to thank CSA. This is a very nice initiative. CSA has always been very dynamic and sort of looking to latest advances in various fields. In addition to adding all the new exciting faculty, I think it's a very good initiative to start on big data. I should also recognize and thank Professor Shivani from CSA for having this idea and getting us all together. Thank you, Shivani. So, since this is the first lecture, I should give you actually a sort of bird's eye view of the whole field in some sense. I'm not very good at bird's eye view, so I will give you a couple of slides which are very general, and then zoom in on a piece of the action, one slice of the field, if you will, and sort of focus on that. So the title of the talk is not Big Data, it's Foundations of Data Science, which is sort of related. It's actually the title of a book I'm writing with John Hopcroft. In the process, we had to think about first the following. What would you call the foundations of data science? The word big data connotes something very jazzy, and so that can have two interpretations. One is something cool or hot or whatever you call it, but perhaps with not so much substance. One is something with a lot of substance. I hope to convince you that it's both. It's hot, but also has a lot of substance. And so the word foundations of data science, this phrase, connotes perhaps the substance part of it. But the question is, what should you consider to be part of the foundations of data science, or what should you teach if you're going to teach a course on data science or foundations of data science, what should you teach? So here's something that if you haven't been to a talk with this sort of title, you wouldn't have seen this, but if you've been to a talk, almost certainly you would have seen a curve like this, which I didn't draw. This is exponential CX for some constant, right? So various forms of this curve, this is the rate of growth of data, if you will, or the rate of growth of storage and speed and so on. They're different constants. Now, there is really a point, I'm not making sort of caricature out of this, but there's really a point in that it's not as if human knowledge has grown exponentially, but it is true that our ability to gather data, to store it, to annotate it has grown, perhaps exponentially. And in fact, so we do have exponential rate of growth of data. But I'm not going to draw you these curves. Perhaps my suggestion is what I'm going to put in the list here, the first few things, maybe the answer is no. They're not what I would consider foundations of data science, but they're important nevertheless. You could also ask, how do you collect and store, annotate, store data in various domains? And in fact, some of these responses will depend on what domain, whether it's biology, astronomy, commerce. I put up three areas here in which we do have, in fact, really a big growth in data that's been collected and stored. But I would like to suggest that this is not, for us, foundations of data science at the moment, partly because it's very important, but it depends on the domain. So it's very specific to each domain, perhaps. Now, you could also say basic statistics is important, because if you have a lot of data, more than you can handle simply by traditional algorithms, surely you must sample. You must draw a random sample of the data and deal with that. So sampling is important. So the study of sampling and basic statistics is perhaps important. Now, basic statistics is always important, but we have to assume that and move on. Now, the later parts of this are becoming progressively more yes answers, but perhaps here is a sort of mea culpa. So I'm a computer scientist, and in particular specialized in algorithms. For the last three decades, perhaps, the area of algorithms focused on discrete structures, graphs, and various other discrete structures. Data structures were a big thing. If you've done computer science courses, you've done lists, arrays, and stacks, and so on and so forth. That was a big thing. Now, also, we spent a couple of decades improving the algorithms for various basic discrete problems, like graph problems, shortest paths and flows. Now, these are very important going forward, but we have focused enough attention on these matters for the last 30 years and learned enough and progressed enough in some sense, which is very good, but we have ignored some other parts, I would like to say, somewhat controversially, we've ignored some other parts in computer science, not overall in human knowledge, in computer science, linear algebra, numerical methods, which have come out to be very important. So if you asked me 20 years ago whether computing eigenvalues or eigenvectors of matrix with million non-zero entries is practical and important in the future, I would have said no, so would most computer scientists. But in fact, this is what is used in basic search. So if you look at how Google does PageRank or ranks the pages on the web, it's based on eigenvalues. I won't tell you how, but it's based on eigenvalues. So in fact, it's been a surprise over the last decade or two that what we might have thought wouldn't scale up, would not be important, has become important. One of them is this. Sampling, not basic sampling, but in fact, most of this talk will be about sampling, but sampling in the context of big data is going to be different from what you might think of as statistical sampling. And that's important, we'll see that. And also very important, it turns out, is high dimensional geometry. We'll see some of this. So in fact, even when you least expect, even for problems which don't look like that, it turns out those problems can be formulated, we'll see some of them, those problems can be formulated as problems to do with, let's say, 10,000 dimensional vectors. Okay. So what does 10,000 dimensional space look like? That turns out to be an important thing to worry about. Probability limit laws, central limit theorem, very classical probability limit laws, they turn out to be very important. Now, you can sort of intuitively guess why. If you have lots of data, you sort of are in the limit, right? And therefore, such things should be more important than, let's say, basic statistics. And indeed, in a lot of these areas, we'll have to develop new tools, and we have developed some, which handles this big data problem. That's what I'm hoping to convince you of this. So, sampling. Okay. So, it's clear that if you have a lot of data, you have to sample so that you get a subsample which is smaller and can be handled. But is it just picking uniformly at random a part of the data? Is that going to be good enough? That's the question we want to ask, right? So, we have 10 million pieces of data, just uniformly at random, pick 10,000 of them and analyze them. Is that what we are going to do? That's what we think of as sampling traditionally, perhaps, or the most elementary method. But here's a problem, typically, that we want to solve. It's an optimization problem. There are many of those. This is one. You have a very large matrix A, M by M matrix. We want to do what's called principal component analysis on A. If you're not familiar with this, bear with me for a moment. You don't have to be at the moment familiar with this. We'll see that a little more. But a lot of you are familiar with this, I'm sure. So that just means we want to find a vector x, so x is an n vector, of unit length, so that when I multiply a with x and take the length, that's as high as possible. So this turns out to be a basic linear algebra problem. This is very important, right? So we want to maximize over all unit length vectors x the length of a. Okay. Now, a is very big, so we can't do the whole problem, perhaps. We can't even necessarily put a into random access memory, so it's going to be difficult to run traditional algorithms. What do? Somehow we like to say we sample A to get a sample out of it, B. Okay. Now, B might have smaller number of rows or columns maybe, or more zeros or something makes it easier. We won't see particularly what at the moment. We want that B to have this property that, see, I don't know what the X is going to be that I'm going to find. So I better have this property that for every red is important. For every x, ax and bx have nearly the same length. If that were true, I could deal with b instead of a, right? If that were true. If that were not true for every x, I cannot do that, right? Because the x I may find may be a bad x for which b gives me the wrong answer, right? So how do I do that? That's the kind of sampling we want to do. We want a sample of a that's good for every x. And x is an n-dimensional vector. There are infinitely many of them. But a rule of thumb, it turns out, in n dimensions, you can pretend there are only e to the n vectors. Okay. It's not true, there are infinitely many, but you can pretend that there are e to the n vectors. That's still a lot of vectors. So this sampling better work for all the vectors, not just for one, right? That's one issue. Here's another issue that can come up in sampling. Big data means that the data is perhaps too big to be stored in one machine or one unit of memory somewhere, right? So it may be distributed among many servers. Now, important sampling. Uniform sampling means everybody gets drawn with probability, which is the same. Important sampling means some items have a higher probability based on their importance. So important sampling is sampling each item with probability proportional to its importance. But then all servers must share the vector of importances, right? They must be sampling with the same vectors to be consistent. Now, maybe the number of items is so large that this vector is costly to transmit. This is the kind of problem we are going to worry about a bit more, both of these problems. By the way, I should tell you, The talk is not exhaustive. I'm not going to tell you all the problems about big data. That's why we have a whole series of lectures you can see here. We'll have many more interesting lectures in this series in the coming months, one a month roughly. So I'm going to cut through a slice of it, and these are some of the problems we'll talk about in detail. So consistency among various servers is one issue. Here's a very simple example that you might want to think about mentally. It's a mental exercise, a very simple one. So I want an average of a set of real numbers, large set of real numbers, big set, right? Now you can just take a sample and take the average, that's an approximation. But the variance may be very high, obviously, right? Variance is how disparate the entries are, might be very high. So how do we achieve low relative error? Now, one thing to focus your mind on is the cancellation problem. Suppose there are lots of positive, big positive entries and lots of big negative entries, and they canceled out, and the total was zero, the average was zero. So if the answer is zero, if you have to make small relative error, you must get it exactly right, right? If the answer is zero, there's no error allowed. If I'm allowing 1% error, the answer is zero, I have to get exactly the answer. So how do you do that? With samples, okay? That's a question. Now, for average, plain, simple average, it's easy. You can just keep a running sum as you read the whole thing, but we'll have to worry about other statistics for which this is not easy, right? So the problem is that the final answer may be very small, and therefore the error allowed may be very small. How do you do it with sample? So these are some of the problems I deal with. I'll tell you some more problems as we go along. Now, sampling is the first major issue. The second major issue we'll deal with in this talk is communication. So again, one definition of what is big data? What's a big data problem? Let's simply define it as data does not fit into random access memory. So every computer has a random access memory. If the data is big enough that doesn't fit in RAM, then we call it big data. That's the sort of working definition of it. So let's say we run a matrix algorithm. You all know traditional matrix algorithms. As the algorithm is running along, a step of the algorithm may say, bring me the ijth entry of the matrix. And in analyzing or implementing that, we assume that can be done in unit time, because if you had random access memory, you can quickly access, that's what random access means, you can quickly access, let's say, each entry of the matrix by putting down its index. Now this we cannot do if it doesn't fit into RAM. So in fact, the traditional paradigm of algorithm design assumes you can do it in unit time, and that already fails. That's a primitive that fails. So people devised models that avoid this assumption. One model is the streaming model. The streaming model says data is written on some external memory and it's streaming. It just goes by. You can only read it once from right to left. So I'll draw a picture here. I've been lazy. I should have drawn pictures on the slide, but that takes a long time. This is a stream, if you will. It flows past. You're sitting here reading it. You can only read it once and it goes away. Well, that per se is not good enough. There is a random access memory, which is much smaller than this stream. So I'll write this as a very small thing. So you can remember some of the stream, let's say by sampling. You sample some of the stream. Uniform sampling is not going to do much good, but there are sophisticated methods that do actually work and solve a lot of problems in this model. I should say the streaming model was the object of study even before the phrase big data was coined. It's studied for the last two decades, and there's quite a body of very nice results. I won't tell you the entire body. The way I'm structuring this talk is I'm going to give you some more or less self-contained vignettes. So we'll see one vignette from streaming data, streaming model, but I won't be able to show you a lot of stuff, right? So now, where does communication come in? So the random access memory, you can think of as communicating information pertaining to the first part of the input to the second part. Okay. So that's how the communication takes place. So when I have read up to this point, this is all gone. Whatever information I need of that is stored in my random access memory. So in some sense, this bit is passing on some, communicating some information to the second part by writing something on the random access memory. That's one way to think of it. So this analogy actually relates space and communication, and this has been studied widely, and it is used to derive lower bounds on space. Okay. Again, a subject that I won't touch very much into, but just a high-level concept. Somehow space is related to communication, okay? Because you've got to write down what you want to communicate to the rest of the input, if you will. So far, I must say, it's been fairly up in the sky. But one more slide of that, and then we'll come to very particular pieces. So streaming is one model that's been studied a lot. A little less restrictive model of big data is that data is split among many servers, okay? But number of servers is much smaller. Now, you could think of streaming as if each bit is sitting on a different computer, different server. That's one way to view this. The only way they communicate is through RAM, right? Otherwise, they cannot communicate. Now, that's, however, if the length of this stream is n, this is thinking of it as n servers. Now, you can argue that a lot of real problems have data that's not so big. In fact, you can accommodate it on log n servers, right? Many smaller, many fewer servers than the amount of data. So that's a better model, perhaps, for a lot of data. And that's one other model we'll study. We'll study both of these. Now, again, up to this point, the talk has been about generalities. Now I want to zoom in on some examples, which are self-contained examples of what's going on. Okay, so let's start with an example. This actually was a starting example and motivated a lot of research on streaming algorithms. We have a large network with lots of computers sending messages to each other. There are routers which route the message, right? So there are n computers, which are, n is very large, perhaps in the millions. But there are routers which are square boxes, maybe there are only 10 of them or 100 of them. And so message from here to here might go through this router, and then it might send it to this, and it might send it to that. Let's say the message finally wants to go there, it'll go there. So it goes through three routers and then goes to the end destination. So we won't worry about the mechanics of routing, let's just study what happens here for the logs of the messages. So the router that sends it to the destination, last one, keeps a log of the message. The log just has, for us, the sending computer's name, I, and the length of the message. That's the log it keeps. Okay? And you want to analyze these logs. You want to do statistics on these logs to better improve the efficiency of the network, let's say. That's our A. So let's say AI is the total length of messages, all the messages sent by computer I in one day, let's say. And you want statistics of AI. The statistics are important to, again, optimize the network. That's the problem we want to solve. Now, statistics, one thing you want to do is perhaps the average of the AI or the total of the AI, but you may want the variance, you may want the second moment. So that's just 1 over n, there are n computers, and n AIs, you sum the AI square and then take the average, right? Let's say we want to do that. Okay. Now, is that simple? Let's see what happens. The trouble is, no router knows AI in full. So I was this computer. It might have sent messages which have gone through many routers, and some of them went here, some of them went there, some of them went there. So nobody knows the full value of AI, right? So if you want to find this, you seem to have to communicate all the partial AIs, and that requires O n space, because there are n computers, you have to communicate for each one the total from each router. So think of the problem actually just for two routers, already interesting. Now, let's get rid of routers, formulate it abstractly. Each router has just an n vector, so this is where vectors come in. There are no vectors to start with, right? This is not a geometry problem. But I'm going to make up vectors. So each router, you can think of as having an n vector, and the components tell you the total length of all messages from each computer that's been logged by this router. So for computer I, all the messages that were logged with this router, that total is kept there, let's say. That's a vector, right? So again, vectors have come in surreptitiously. They have nothing to do with the problem, but we formulate it as vectors. We'll see the advantage of that. It's not a bookkeeping device that I put down vectors for keeping track of this. It's more than a bookkeeping device. Okay. So what we want to find, I say our last inner sum is over T. So we want to take the sum over all routers of the total length of message logged by that router coming from I. I want to sum inside first, then square, and then add. Okay. It would have been nice if the sum was outside. The trouble is the sum is inside, so you have to first total over all routers for each I, square, and then sum over all I, right? And that's a problem, because this information is not contained in anybody. Now, if you don't follow the exact mechanics, that's fine. I'm going to abstract it even more. That makes life a lot simpler. So here's the vector problem. This is the abstract problem we want to solve. There's an n-component vector, bold faces vectors, a sub t residing in server t, and we want to take the sum, and we want to estimate the length squared of the sum, right? Sum of squares of that. We want to sum the vectors component-wise and take the sum of squares. If you had the whole vector and we could write it down, this is a trivial problem, but we don't want to write down the whole vector. So we want to use very little communication compared to the number of components. How do we do that? Okay, so maybe I can sample k of the n components of the vector v, right? The v has too many components, I don't want to write them all down. Maybe I can sample k and just collect information on that. Is that any good? The answer is, in general, no. The variance can be very high. Some components can be much higher than other components. So this will be a loss if you did that. But here is a beautiful theorem, which is a geometry theorem. Now you see that geometry is necessary and useful, called the Johnson-Lindenstrauss theorem. If you perhaps don't remember anything from this talk, hopefully you can take this home if you didn't see it before. So this theorem says the following. If I pick a matrix R, which has a small number of rows, K is supposed to be small, matrix, independent random unit vectors. So they're independent random vectors with unit length as rows. Then I take the length of R times V, and that tells me the length of V. Well, there's a little scale factor here, don't worry about that, which is a known factor, we know this, so we don't care. It tells me the length of V. So a little picture, schematic picture here. So we had a vector x with a lot of components, n components, and we multiply it by an r, which is a very small number of rows. It becomes now a k vector. This is rx. And it's enough to find the length of that, right? So what we did was, again, we had to find the length, some n things squared. Instead, this says a sample of k things will do. Not a plain sample. That won't do, right? But this kind of random vector, then multiply it, it'll do. Okay? The proof is not difficult. I mean, obviously, I won't do the proof here, but the proof is not difficult. But what it says is that a sample of k components, plain components, won't do, but a sample of k combinations of components will do. Okay? So, now the trouble is this, if all servers happen to have the same random matrix R, they can do their own R times AT and send these vectors. Now these are only K vectors, they're very small. Okay? They can send these vectors over to a central processor which can sum the vectors, and since things are linear, it can find R times V and compute the length. But you need to know the same R. Everybody needs the same R. Okay? How do we do that? We need a lot of communication, it seems, to agree on one R. And this has been a central problem, and I want to isolate this problem now. Forget the vector problem. How to share randomness? This is a very important problem, it turns out, in many areas. How can many servers share the same? They have to agree on the same n-bit random string, right? Without transmitting n amount, right? They all have to have exactly the same random string. How do they do that? The string has n bits of information, so it seems to need n bits of communication. We'll see how to get around that. But for many applications of this problem, as well as other problems in distributed computing, complexity theory, and cryptography, we don't need all the components to be independent. We need only what's called four-way independence. Now, four-way independence is every set of four or fewer bits are independent. So full independence is the entire thing should be independent mutually. But we only need every collection of 4 bits or 3 bits or 2 bits or 1 bit to be independent. That's enough, it turns out. Now, four-way independent things are easier to get. Coding theory and coding theory gives us this. It's actually a very classic code. So here's one way to get a four-way independent string, very long string, but a four-way independent. I pick at random coefficients, four coefficients, and form a degree 3 polynomial, a0 plus a1x plus a2x squared plus a3x cubed. It's a real polynomial, right? Just a polynomial of degree 3. Then I evaluate this polynomial at n points, p at 1, p at 2, and p at n, and so on. What happens is that this string, which is much longer than 4, right, it's n length, is four-way independent. And you have to do it over a finite field, but this is the idea. There are 4 degrees of freedom, right? 4 degrees of independence, a1, a0, a1, a3, a4. And that suffices to give four-way independence. Now, these are called pseudo-random sequences, and many of you will know this. Now, the answer for the communication problem is simple. You just generate the seed, some central location, and transmit the seed, a0, a1, a2, a3, centrally, and transmit to all servers. They can individually find the string. And the strings will all be the same, right? It's the same seed, so they'll all be the same. So they've agreed on an n-length random string with just very little transmission. And that the communicating randomness like this is an important primitive. So finishing the vector problem, as I said, there was an important paper due to Alon, Matthias, and Zaghetti about 15 years back, which started the field of streaming algorithms. So I want to go through what we have, more or less summarizing what we have. There's a central processor which generates a seed for the random matrix. It transmits the seeds to all the servers. Servers just find apply R to their individual, so they build up the whole matrix from the seed, apply this, and then send it to the central processor, which sums up all these things, and then finds the length. Okay. If server T did not have it explicitly, so it's possible that server T did not have it explicitly, but we had only the streaming model. Okay. It only has a log of every entry, but the logs are in arbitrary order. They're not sorted, so they're not sorted all together for one I. But whenever I see that the ith source has sent a message of length A, then a little thought will tell you all I have to do to R times AT is updated by adding A times column I of R to R times AT. Again, it's not important to remember the details, but the point is whatever order I give these logs, I can update my vector matrix vector product. And you can do this in the streaming model once I have the seed. Now, that, yeah, sure. So V is not available locally. We have only these ATs. V is the sum of what's available locally. So V is the vector sum of vectors available at each server. Okay. And we want to be able to estimate the length of the sum rather than each individual one. Yeah? Ask me other questions if you have this. We can go slow and not, you know, better. Yeah? So, I'm talking about scenarios where each server has a certain amount of information, but we want some statistics of the total, right? And we are not allowed to just transmit the whole vector, that's too costly. Basically, how to save on communication. So I want to study something called higher order correlation. So let's say you have time series data of n events, and over t time steps, n and t are supposed to be large. This is, again, large data. So aij is 1 or 0, depending on whether event ei happened at time tj. So whether the ith event happened at time j, if so, then aij is 1 or 0. So this is time series, right? Time series just means for each event, I have a long string of zeros and ones, which tells you when the event happened, when it did. Now, pairwise correlations wants to know how many pairs of events co-occurred. So you want triples EI, E1, E2, T, so that E1 and E2 both occur at time T. So E1 and E2 co-occur at time T, how many times they co-occur, add them up. This is clearly of interest. I won't motivate it, but I'll give you some examples in a minute. But it turns out higher order correlations are also of interest. We have four events, E1 through E4, and T times three time steps, and we want to know how many such things where all four occurred at all these three times, right? It turns out there's some actually natural motivations which I won't describe in detail. These higher order correlations are important in a lot of contexts. One is neuron firing, but we'll see a couple of other examples in this slide. Now, the big data again means that the events are split among servers. So no server knows all the events. Each server knows some of the events. So each server knows some of these time series, right? Nobody knows all of them. Another example of this is from commercial data, right? Customers buying products. Each customer is on one server, and you want to know, for instance, how many triples of customers and products are there so that all three bought quite a bit of these two. So these kinds of analysis are necessary. For instance, they optimize what product should be put where and so on and so forth. Again, the details of what the exact problem is not important, but it's this correlation that we want to know. So documents and terms in an information retrieval, co-occurrence of terms, trigrams or triples of terms, whether they co-occur and how many times they co-occur are important. That's a very exact similar problem to this. Okay. Here's the abstract formulation. You have a bipartite graph. So I can draw it on the board. So one side we have events. The other side we have time steps. And you put an arrow if it occurred. So some things occurred, some things didn't. The whole graph is not present in any server. Servers only know for one particular event what are all the time steps when it happened, perhaps these two. And some other server, maybe the elliptic server might know some of the other stuff. The square server might know some of this. That's the situation. So, you can think of this. Okay, here's a concrete version of this problem. Estimate the number of 2-4 subgraphs with each of the two left vertices connected to at least 3 of the 4 right vertices. So, it's not, again, very important exactly what happens, but here's a graph with 2 vertices on the left and 4 on the left, 4 on the right, and you want to study the connections. You want to do the averages of this over all sets of 2 and 4, right? That's total. You want the statistics with it. And the point is the data split. So you can formulate this as a bipartite graph with left and right vertices. It turns out this problem, and I'm going to go over this quickly. If you don't follow this, don't worry about it. But this problem is more or less exactly the vector problem, for reasons that will become clear. So it's a vector problem in a very high number of dimensions. So if there are 10 right vertices, you form a 10 to the 4 component vector V, and it's that vector's length we want. So component VI is the number of left vertices connected to at least 3 of the 4 right vertices. Again, you need not follow exactly all the details, but it's very simple. And the answer we want is more or less the squared length of V. It's the same problem that we had earlier, okay? But in a very high dimensional space. So if there are n vertices here, it'll be n choose 4 dimensions. So n to the 4 dimensional space. So this is an example where the number of dimensions is even bigger than what you started with. Okay. Now it turns out that can be computed by the previous algorithm, but you don't necessarily, in the neuron firing case, it turns out 2 is not enough. You want higher order correlations than 2. So then, So what we did is only for 2, what do we do for higher order? Now I'm going to go over this quickly, but in the abstract setting now. You have a vector V with n non-negative components. We want, which is actually not in one place. It's a sum of vectors at different servers. Again, the same as before. But now we want to estimate the kth moment. We want the sum of the kth powers. K is larger than 2, perhaps. K is 3, 4, something else. Right? How do we do that? The methods for 2 don't apply. This beautiful theorem which I erased doesn't work anymore. It turns out that sort of theorem only works for two, no more than anything higher than two. But in a recent paper, we showed that it can be done with not too much communication. It turns out to be enough for each server to do its own important sampling according to its own vectors components raised to the kth power. So I would have liked to draw samples according to some vector to the kth power. It suffices, it's important to do it individually, each server, and then exchange a bit of communication. This is not trivial, but I won't tell you the details, but important sampling per server is enough. That's the point of the story. Now, I want to go to the next topic. Perhaps if there are any questions, briefly, we can, I don't know whether there are any. If I've gone fast enough that maybe you're all lost, which is fine then. Any questions? So important uniform sampling is just everybody, every item is uniformly likely to be picked. Important sampling means the probabilities are not uniform. That's all. How do you pick the importance? In this case, it's proportional. In the previous slide, it was proportional to the kth power of bi. Okay. That's what we would have liked to do, but we don't have the vector v. So instead, it turns out enough each server does its own. It's maybe advantageous because you can speed up computation. But here we are looking at data being so big that it is being put on very many servers. Or in the network routing case, there are different routers. They just log messages, right? Each one. If you want them all to collect in one place, you need a huge amount of memory, so you can't do that. Anything else? Yeah?
What is the typical value of k?
So the answer to that is I'm a theoretician. Well, you know, this is a model in which, okay, k typically wants to be small. Oh, the dimension of the number of rows. It's logarithmic, actually. It's only logarithmic. It's much smaller than n. So Johnson Lennon Strauss lets you go with logarithmic. Oh, I thought you meant this k. But yeah. This k is also small. Anything else? Okay, good. So let me quickly do principal component analysis. So we have a large matrix in this case. And the matrix you can think of is each row is a data point. There are m points in n space, n dimension. The number of points is much larger than the dimension. So maybe they all live in 10-dimensional space, there are a million points. Or 200-dimensional space, there are a million points, right? So basic concept of linear algebra, again, this is a recapitulating this. You want to find the unit vector x, which maximizes the length of ax. That's called the first principal component. Unit vector y, perpendicular to the first principal component, maximizing this, called the second principal component, and so on. Again, a lot of you are familiar with this. If not, just think of it as an optimization problem, right? Very nice linear algebra theory. For many problems, you want to find these. Now, big data, the matrix x, a, may not be stored all in one server. Here's a simple model we can think of. There are many servers. Each stores a similar dimension matrix. So the whole dimension is there, but maybe there are a lot of zeros in each server, so the data itself is smaller. And you want to deal with the sum of all the matrices. But you don't want to communicate all of that, right? So you want to find principal components of the sum, but communicate only a tiny fraction of the whole data among the servers. Okay. So PCA for distributed data, server T has matrix AT, you want to sum and take the principal component. How do we do that? Again, so I want to keep the theme to this random sampling stuff, Johnson-Lennon stuff in some sense. We use that. That told us that there's a random, if you pick a random matrix R, then the length of X for every vector X, R times A times X. Now, in the old setup, we multiplied R by a vector. Well, A times X is a vector, right? So R times A times X, the length is a good estimate of the length of A times X. I really want the length of A times X, but it's enough to do this. R makes it much smaller, we erase that. R makes it much smaller so you can communicate that. But now, if this is only true for one x, then it wouldn't help us. But if it were true for every x, this is the optimization problem that I first pointed out. If this were true for every x, we could just solve the problem on R times A instead of A, right? Because the x I find for R times A should also be good for A, if this kind of relation is true for every x. And in fact, it turns out, well, the number of x's is exponential in n, but Johnson-Lindenstrauss, now this is one more step, gives us a low enough probability of failure for one x that we get this actually works for every x simultaneously, for all the x's simultaneously. Okay. Not only is this true for one x, it's true for every x at the same time. Okay, that's asking for a lot, because there are many, many x's. But that's given to us. So there's one random matrix R. So again, the picture was, oh, I think I have a picture on the next slide. There's one random matrix R, so that R times A times X and A times X are similar length for every X, where big N is not very big. Okay. So picture here would make it clearer. Here's a big matrix. Here's a R times A, which is far fewer rows, with the same number of columns, but has a very nice property that for any vector X that you can think of, the length of A applied to X and the length of RA applied to X are similar. Okay. That's quite a striking property. So anything you want to do with A, you can do with R times A, because all these lengths are preserved. So that finishes PCA, which is a very brief thing. Now the area of distributed data problems, as far as big data goes, a big part of big data is that data is distributed. So there are many problems that people are currently studying, how to do linear, nonlinear problems. Optimization problems is an important thing in this model. Machine learning in the distributed setting is an active area. There are dynamic versions of these questions you can ask where the data is subject to updates. There are some papers here. I point out only one reference, but there are many references here. Okay, good. I want to do one more topic. I picked this topic partly because it relates to it, partly because it's very beautiful recent work, and one of the co-authors is in Bangalore, actually, so I thought it'd be nice to do. So this is called sparsification, which is another twist on sampling. Okay. Now we already saw that if you have a matrix A which is big, we can compress it by using a random matrix A in front. You get R times A, right? Now you can think of RA as combinations of the rows of A, right? RA is a combination of the rows of A. So instead of RA, instead of combining the rows of A, is it possible to just take a sample, a subset of rows, not combinations, but subset of rows? Maybe with weights, and make that do this job. Okay. How about graphs? Because graphs are special cases of matrices. So here's a picture, a description of what a graph looks like. Now I've gone to columns instead of rows, excuse me. So here's a graph. It's represented by this edge node adjacency matrix. So edge one goes from A to B. So I put a plus one on A, minus one on B. This is vertex A and vertex B. Similarly, edge two goes from B to C. That's that edge, B to C, and so on. I put down this matrix. And here's a cut which cuts the graph into two pieces. Okay. I look at all the edges going across the cut, these three edges now going across that cut. It turns out, and this is a calculation you don't have to do in this part, it turns out I can represent the cut by a vector which puts ones on the vertices on the left bank, these two, A and D, and zero for the vertices on the right bank, B and C of the cut. And if I take the length of the vector VA squared, that's the size of the cut. It's always true, but you have to prove this. So from this, we can formulate the following problem, which is exactly the same as what I had before. So I want now but a subset of edges, a subset of columns, so that the length of VB and the length of VA are close. I don't want a combination. I want a subset. Okay. So in pictures, this is for graphs. Here's a graph on 10 vertices, which has all the 10 choose 2 edges. So it's a lot of edges. If n vertices that have n choose two edges, that's many, many edges. Can I sample a subset of edges? So in this case, I have, I think, 15 edges instead of 10 choose two. And perhaps I weight them. I make them thicker so that I want to guarantee, I want to guarantee that any cut I make, so there are n vertices, I can cut them into two to the n possible ways. Any cut I make here and I make here has the same value. I take the total number of edges crossing this cut, I take the total weight of edges crossing this cut, they must be the same, roughly the same. Okay? So again, I want to sparsify the graph, choose a subset of edges, so that every cut here has roughly the same weight as the corresponding cut here. That's a problem we might want to solve. And here's a problem with this setup. Here's a pathological graph. If you had a graph which is very dense here and very dense here, and only one edge connecting the two, this is called a dumbbell graph. Here's a cut, just cutting it into two pieces. There is one edge crossing it. I better get this edge in my sample, otherwise I'll get a zero instead of one. That's not good. That's not good relative error, right? Zero is not within relative error 1% of one. So if I want to sparsify this graph, I better always pick this edge. So uniform sampling of the edges will not do. I have to do something else. And a beautiful theorem of Spielman, Feng, and Srivastava, Nikhil Srivastava is at Microsoft in Bangalore, says that if you have an M by N matrix where M is larger than N, there is a probability distribution. It cannot be uniform. I have to make sure I put a high probability on this edge. There's a probability distribution we can put on the rows of A so that if we do IID sampling of a certain number of rows, only n log n rows, small number of rows, think of it, according to the distribution, then for every x, length of ax and length of bx are the same. And that turns out answers the cut problem for a reason I won't actually describe. And if A actually came from a graph, like the last one, sampling probabilities are proportional to the electrical resistances when you view the graph as a resistive network. And in fact, sampling can be done in nearly linear time. So again, I have a graph. I must sample a certain set of edges, small number of edges, so that every cut is correctly represented. And they say, we can do that, provided you choose the right probabilities. You cannot do that if you choose uniform probabilities, right? And the probabilities are proportional to the electrical resistance. So this theorem they proved about 5 years back. There's been a lot of work on this area. And one of the people who's worked on this area is Ramesh Hariharan, who's our next speaker in this series. He'll talk next month, perhaps not about this, but something else. But he's also from Bangalore, so he's done quite a bit of work on this also. Now, this led to something quite unexpected proved about 2 months ago, and that's the which also Nikhil Srivastava was one of the co-authors. There's a beautiful result that settles a classic mathematics problem, and the problem is actually very important in quantum theory as well as operator theory. But it's one of those few things which can be stated very simply to do with vectors. I won't be able to describe what connection it has to the previous theorem, but it does. It's actually connected to the previous theorem. So if big data you thought was only going to let you handle big data, well, here is something very fundamental that came out of not necessarily staring at big data, but something that has to do with compression and sparsification. So the theorem here says the following. You have a finite set of vectors. This is going somewhat far afield, but I want to tell you this theorem because it's a spectacular achievement, right? By these people. So if you have a finite set of vectors which are in what's called inertial position means the set of vectors is t. Inertial position means you take any vector x and sum of the squares of x dot v, dot product, over the set, that's exactly the length squared. So you may think of as this as the energy of x in the direction v. So this says the energy of x, you know, together along the directions in T is exactly the length squared. So that needs to be true, and no vector should be big. So vectors are all small in length. Then you can always partition this set of vectors into two sets. that are about half inertial. So this was about x squared. Each set is about half inertial. So for every x, I take the sum of vectors in the first part of the energy squared in that direction. That's approximately x squared over 2 for the first set. So it must be true for the second set also, right? Because the total is x squared. So it turns out, again, this settles actually a very long-standing problem in operator theory. Now, this has something to do with graph sparsification. In fact, that was the starting point. This actually says that not only can you cut up a graph, can you sparsify a graph, you can actually split it up into very sparse pieces. You can split it up into many pieces, each of which is sparse, provided some condition holds. That's what this theorem ends up saying, in a way that I won't be able to completely describe. But I believe that's all. So I'm done. We are now open to questions if you want. Oh, in terms of epsilon. So in terms of whatever epsilon required, the number of rows will grow as 1 over epsilon squared. So not too bad. And in terms of n, it's only log.
The first generation of big data you had about something does not fit RAM. That's been true for all time that we have used computers, right? Why is it called big data?
No. OK, so good point. So it's true in it has been true in practice for a long time. But in theory, the paradigm we had for algorithms was, I store my graph or my matrix or my input to my any problem in RAM, and then I can quickly access various things. We never, well, not never, we almost never worried about access problems if data was not stored in memory. We did sometimes. There is some literature, but we didn't sort of seriously worry about that. But big data means, even in theory, we better seriously worry about that somehow.
One other question.
Yeah.
Sampling, is there any connection theoretically to this Nyquist sampling about minimum frequency of sampling equivalent in big data as to some
what
theoretical
is
work on? Is there something equivalent?
Yeah, so is there an optimal sampling rate that we need? We don't often know the optimal answer. Nyquist is a nice theorem, we know the optimal answer. We often don't know the optimal answer. We know lower and upper bounds which don't quite meet. But in a few cases, we do know the optimal answer.
There is work in that kind of
thing. It's work in that kind of thing, but lower bounds are very hard to come by. That's the problem. Whereas Nyquist sampling is something else, so lower bounds were also possible there.
Yeah. In your presentation, you are dealing with only numerical data. I mean, you are not talking
about
variety.
Good point, good point. Throughout the talk, I only focused on numerical data, partly to spite my friends who focused on Boolean variables for too long, but partly it's the following. Machine learning, in general, or other subjects, have feature vectors. Feature vectors can have Boolean fields, but generally, it's much nicer to deal with real data because there's a lot more structure.
But some of this, text or even pictures, video, audio, and all that, can they be converted into numerical?
Okay, actually, that's a very good question. So, for instance, if you have 0-1. So for things occurring or not occurring, 0 or 1. Now, the numerical distance squared between those two is, of course, the number of 1 zeros, number of flips. Or the dot product, for instance. Even though they're Boolean, the dot product is the number of common. So there are connections like this which can be spun. Now, it turns out, actually, it's a very good point you raised. It turns out, for instance, for the web matrix, you have the point of matrix of hypertext links. So there's a 1 in the ij position if the ith web page linked to the jth web page. Now this is purely a Boolean thing. But you take that matrix and do eigenvalue analysis of it, that's how you get page rank. And the reason it works is distance is squared and dot products make sense, as if they were reals, even though they are Booleans.
So I've heard a lot of big data talks, and oftentimes they're about the systems aspect of big data, and it was fascinating here the foundational aspects of big data.
Completely removed from reality, I'm sorry, but yeah, that's true.
So where does theory and practice meet, and how do they meet?
Okay. Actually, that's a good question. So for instance, this idea of using Johnson-Lindman straws, right, really in a way comes from theory. Okay. So, I mean, in fact, I probably want to claim, I'm not completely sure, I would think that theoreticians are the first to think of random predictions, because this theorem was around. Okay, so we proved this theorem that says if you take a number of rows 100 log n over epsilon squared, then I can prove that this works. Well, in practice, that's too big, but however, it guides practice in the sense the whole method comes from theory. Now, in practice, you can go and say, I'll use only 5 log n over epsilon, and that works beautifully. So we need okay, we need two things. We need empirical studies to translate this theory into practice, because the bounds may be prohibitive. We also need the other way mechanism. In practice, people use certain heuristics or algorithms. I mean, people are happy using the k-means algorithm for anything they want. It always works. Theoreticians are puzzled that it always works, and we are still trying to prove that there are cases where it works. But in trying to prove that, maybe we come up with twists that are interesting in practice. So that's probably both ways that would go. But I say all this vector stuff came from theory in some sense.
So the problem on principal component analysis on distributed data, so what are the objectives there? So one of the things is you want to compress it to within maybe a target, right?
Yeah.
And then of all possible ways, all those R matrices, all possible ways by which you can compress it to that size, so are there analytical lower bounds on the amount of communication that is needed, and
yes,
which is
there are lower bounds. Actually, it turns out this algorithm meets the upper and lower. This is one of these algorithms which actually is tight, but the lower bounds were there for that problem already. So I can give you references, but roughly I won't tell you the exact lower bound, but yeah, in this case, the lower and upper bounds meet. So also for the VI to the K, there are lower bounds that meet the upper bounds also.
This bipartite graph you draw, right? I mean, yeah. You said each server has its own respective information, but how do you combine then finally to get this?
So that's due to the important sampling. So the moral of what I said was that each server does important sampling just on its own events. And somehow that's enough, it turns out, with some exchanges and rejection sampling, which I didn't go into. That's enough to do something which is as if important sampling on the whole thing, or the sum. So there's some work to be shown there. I didn't show it. I'll move to the other side. No, I won't move to the other side.
Okay. So on this geometric embedding of symbolic problems and so on, you know, of course, in logic, you can also embed many problems in logic.
Yeah.
Is there a sort of a sampling theorem there that's striking in logic?
For logic.
So for theorem proving or for compactness.
Yeah. See, I don't know. The difficulty would be for theorem proving, you want the exact thing, right? So the closest thing I can think of is the programming languages people to verify a program. I mean, you would like a theorem that says the problem is always true, which is often difficult to prove. They do have sampling methods of generating random inputs on which it's enough to check so that you can assert with high probability. Uniform sampling is not enough there also, but there are ways of coming up, but not full-fledged provable ways, but they have heuristic ways of coming up with test data.
Yeah, but there could be other things like finding deep resolvents or sort of steps in theorem proving.
That's right.
Could come from John.
Yeah, maybe some steps can be subject to sampling, but I don't know much of anything that on those lines, actually. Yeah.
Hello, this is really not a data scientist question as such. I mean, think of me as a layman asking a question to professors, right? So to what extent all these algorithms have been implemented? Say, I'm from a software background and I'm an entrepreneur, and
yeah.
I'm trying to implement these things with respect to a field problem. To what extent are these implemented so that they're usable?
Okay. I don't know a lot about whether streaming algorithms have been implemented, but perhaps they have been. They are around. The matrix algorithms, actually, people have begun to study in these distributed architectures. I know you may be familiar with MapReduce. That's one particular discrete distributed architecture of how the machines interact, which Google built. And there have now been maybe, I would say, 2 or 3 year old studies of the matrix algorithms. Streaming, I would guess, is implemented, but I don't know precisely. The matrix algorithm you do want to solve. It's you have large matrices and you want to do this. Oh, and clustering is another example which people have implemented. K-means, I didn't talk about that. In MapReduce and other settings, there has been some study.
In fact, just to add to that or add a question to that, actually, one of the streams of activity here is to take very well-established algorithms like clustering, singular value decomposition. They've been around for a while, but put them on a sort of more firm foundational basis where you understand when they work, when they don't, how you can sample them to make them faster, et cetera. I think that's clearly one of the streams. So along that line, I had a question which would be, are there other methods that are very well-established, like analogs of SVD, clustering, et cetera, which clearly have an impact in practice but do not have a mathematical foundation yet, which we all need to look at? Are there examples of those?
Yeah, certainly. Graphical models, belief propagation are examples where there is some theory but not enough. Deep learning is a big, so there's a subject called deep learning that the machine learning people have devised over the last maybe 10 years. It is supposed to be spectacular. No theory establishing that as such. Topic modeling is another area that one of our future speakers, Chiranjeev, works on. Is another area where there's a lot of heuristic methods. We perhaps have fewer proofs, and things need to be proved on those lines. So, I mean, there are a lot. So I would say, so both ways, right? One question was how to take theory to practice, but there's the other way that practical people, I mean, they are generally happier people because whatever they use, it seems to work. But we can't prove anything. I mean, it makes us unhappy, but that might be another way to go also.
There is another basic question from my side, like even if we go with all these algorithms, being a kind of, if I look at from the software point of view or application point of view, how I can get the data into this term, like vector and matrices, and so I can implement through the application side also.
Okay, so that's a question. More generally, you might have big data that you have to annotate. I mean, that's a huge problem. I mean, in biology and astronomy and so on, there's a huge problem. I don't know whether there is a sort of simple solution for that. Obviously not, because every domain has to do its own. Now, as far as these specific things, how to convert them into vectors, this more or less come as these logs, right? Was just messages, source, and for instance, source and number of packets. It's very easy to run through the log and build your vector. That's what we were saying. So in some of these instances, easy, but more generally, the problem of how to make data not only machine readable, but intelligible, sort of, is a big problem, for which I don't think I have a solution. So this is a quiet, I can come to the quiet side. And
all the questions, we are almost on that side. Questions will come from there.
Unless we are done with time.
Any other questions? Okay, so if there are no more questions, then we'll thank Ravi again for a very interesting talk.
Well, thank you.
This is a very small gift for a very big lecture.
Well, the next one will say big data.
I'd just like to mention, and those of you who don't know, Ravi is writing, he mentioned at the beginning, a foundational book on this topic, and some of it might be available on the web.
It's available to download, yes.
It's at least even for me, who's been in this community for a while, to have all of these different algorithms strung together under a very nice umbrella that relates now to the themes in the world is certainly very interesting, very foundational. So I would encourage all of you to take a look at it.
Yeah, feel free to download it and use it anyway.
Thanks, Ravi, again, and. it over to Professor Nair. No? Okay, so we do have coffee right next door, so please help yourself there, and then we'll meet again in a month's time for the next lecture, and details will be up on the website.
So thanks for coming, and thanks for the questions.